different from the usual for the moment. I will assume that I have a convex function, which is smooth. And eventually, we are going to work on the plane. I have also a closed convex set on which we are going to minimize f. But most of the time, again, there will be no constraint. Okay. So, and the question for me here is, what could go wrong in such a context? Many things are going well, this we know for sure, but there are many open questions about convergence, about rigidity, about inequalities, and this is what I want to investigate. Sorry, I think I forgot to say that it is joint work with Edouard Powels, who did an amazing job on this, a friend and colleague from Toulouse. Okay, so let me introduce you to this problem through open question first, with algorithm that you know all very well. So we first start with the Gauss-Seidel method, in which you want to minimize a function, and you do this alternatively by block, as you know, like that, and it is pretty easy to prove that we have convergence toward the minimizer. But even when the sequence is well defined, the question of convergence is open. The same is true for gradient descent with exact line search here. Okay. So you follow the gradient. And you choose the step that minimize, that achieve the best score for the function f along the gradient line. And again, we know that it converges to the minimizer of f, but the sequence, the behavior of the sequence is mysterious. A more involved example that Yuri have partially presented is this Bregman or mirror descent method. Okay, which is a non-Euclidean version of the constant step gradient method. So I think that here I have been a bit too bold. The step has to be lower than 1/n. So here we assume some kind of smoothness with respect to the function f related to the kernel. And it is, again, well known that in most cases, the value of the problem converges to the minimum. We even have some complexity results, but there is no real knowledge of the convergence, or only partial knowledge. So let me finish this list of counterexamples by a dynamical system. So it's an old dynamical system. First considered by Cauchy in the 19th century for optimization purposes as well. So it's the gradient system. So basically, we are interested in curves that are orthogonal to the level lines. And as you know, these curves are hoped to converge to the minimum. In the convex case, it is true, we know that it's true in a Hilbert space even, and convergence is weak. But we could go further and wonder how the curves are behaving in terms of directions, okay? So what we could do, I'm going to take very simple setting. We work on the plane. The function has a unique minimizer. It's convex, it has a unique minimizer. And we assume that it has positive definition everywhere, save perhaps at x star, okay? And we look at the direction of the gradient curve. Does it converge? Okay, so it's an interesting question, at least geometrically. Perhaps one day it will be useful in optimization as well. And what happens is that the answer to the to the, this open question is always no, okay? And my goal is to provide a counterexample and even a method to building this counterexample. Okay, so I will start to illustrate my views on a simple case, the Gauss-Seidel case, as a block coordinate method, okay? Please, I didn't say it, but do not hesitate to stop me if you want to ask questions. Okay, so first, we need, in this type of question, to fill geometrically the problem. So a few comments are in order. So we are going to work in the plane, in R2, okay? So the algorithm is very simple, one alternatively minimized with respect to the coordinates, okay? And there is an assumption also that we make. We make the assumption that for the sequence we look at, ui plus 1 and vi plus 1 are always uniquely defined. Okay, so of course, if we want convergence, we must have some kind of control at this part of the process. And so what geometrical remark we can make? Well, if we write the optimality condition for this, we obtain this result by Fermat rule. And so it means that the gradient at ui plus 1 vi is parallel to the y-axis. And again, with the other, with the next term, we have a parallelism with the x-axis. And of course, we have orthogonality with the level lines as usual. Okay? So now the idea is to guess what a pathological situation could be. And so we are going to imagine a function that have bad behavior. So so here we look at this function. So the bluish rounded squares are sublevel sets, okay? The lighter, here you have the argmin, okay, in black. And the lighter the blue is, the higher the value of the function is, okay? So you have like a bulge, but not the square cut. Okay. And I also make you observe that on the white part, f is greater than 1, and on the blue part, f is lower than 1. And we start from here, okay? Why not? And since we are doing Gauss-Seidel, we minimize over here. And since the line is drawn on the white part, the value of the function is always greater than 1, and there is only one case in which it is 1, it is here. So it is the point that that is interesting for us. So if we start from here, we are going there, okay? And indeed, we recover the optimality condition. We actually reproved it geometrically. And we do that again. Okay, so we are here, and we minimize now with respect to the E variable, and we go there. The minimum is here, orthogonality with the gradient again, and we go there, and there, and there, okay? So the idea is the idea of having rotating bumps, and so this gives you a spiraling sequence, okay? So this is at this stage it's a bit cafe discussion because the intuition is interesting, but does this function exist? And this is all the problem we are facing. We want this type of function to exist, and we want them to be very smooth. Okay. and convex, of course, which is an important, very important difficulty. So we are led to what we called, I don't know if it is called like that in the literature, but we call this continuous convex interpolation problem or convex interpolation problem. So let's now make a short summary of what happened. So to put an algorithm or a property in default, we have a strategy. We guess and draw a pathological sequence of convex sets, and then we try to turn them into a counterexample. So we need to find a convex function for which this set that we have drawn are level sets. So let formalize this. We take a decreasing sequence of convex compact set with non-empty interior, and we assume that the decrease is frank. Okay, the boundaries must not touch. Okay, and we have the convex interpolation. The continuous interpolation problem, which is find F convex such that the TI are sublevel set of F. Okay? So this is not a new question. We find it in old work of the 50s, in definitive, essential, and there are resolution of this interpolation problem by Kanai from Brochard also, I guess, and Toraba, who didn't know the work. In order for you to understand what I do in the smooth case, I need to recall what are the principles to build the continuous interpolation. So we are going to build this interpolation progressively. So we start with two sets, T0 and T1. T0 is the bigger, okay? And we want to interpolate in between this set. So we are going to make something very elementary. We are going to make a convex combination in the Minkowski sense of T0 and T1. Okay? So I ask you to keep this in mind. We are going to use it a lot. And here you have a picture of what it gives. So this, the big set is T0. The small one is T1, and the other one are the T lambdas. Okay? So it is nice now because we have candidates for being level sets. And to build a function above this, we only need to assign values. Okay? And we could do a simple choice, linear choice. We assign a linear. Value with a linear dependence to lambda. Okay, so basically you have a truncated round pyramid, if you want. Okay? So, okay, this is for two sublevel. Now let's go to three. Three is a bit different. So we have here you see a first interpolation and there a second one. Okay? What we can say is that it is pretty easy to build a quasi-convex function that interpolates all these guys and even all the sequence. How do you do? Well, first you choose a sequence lambda I of value of f, well, that will become value for f. So lambda I is positive and decreases to zero. You assign the value lambda I to each TI. Okay? And now, for any lambda, you look, this lambda is always in between two lambda I, and you make this type of interpolation, okay, for the sublevel set. And this gives you the function. A function that is quasi-convex. since all the sublevel are convex. And in addition, there is something interesting. The argmin of your function is the intersection of all the TI. Okay? Well, you ask the function to be zero on this intersection. You could do something else, but it's for us, it's what we want. Okay. But of course there is the problem because we don't want quasi-convex function. We want convex function. And with very simple examples, of the one I am displaying, you take concentric circles. This and you can interpolate this like that, convex, like that, convex and smooth, or like that. And this is not convex, so we need to find a clever way to arrange values. And this clever way has been given by these people. So the idea is not very difficult. So what they did is that they translate the slope monotonicity characterization of convex function, okay? The slope on lines must increase. They translate this in terms of sub-level sets. And so we have this theorem which says if you start with a quasi-convex function, then it is convex if the support of your function is satisfies nice property that I won't describe, it's not fundamental for us. I can come back later. Basically, for us, it means that the sequence of value lambda I that we are choosing must decrease fast enough. And we can measure the fastness with with this rate of decrease. Okay. And so this is how we can establish the theorem of Kanai Toralba. You take your frankly decreasing sequence of convex compact set, then you can interpolate this sequence by a continuous convex function, and the argmin of your function is the intersection of the TI. Okay? But for us, it's not enough because we want to work in the smooth world, okay? So we are led to consider the problem of smooth convex interpolation, which I have been thinking to for 10 years now. So it's quite tricky. I'm going to try to explain you how it works. So we are going to pertain to the plane R2. So this is a very small scale part, I'm sorry. The degree can be as big as you want of the regularity. And you take your sequence of decreasing convex set, and now you assume that they have CK boundary, okay? CK manifold. And you would like to have a function from R2 to R, which is convex CK, which has the TI as sublevel set. And in addition, we want the argmin of this function to be the intersection. And we also have some many constraints that we have considered. For instance, having positivation out of the argmin, when can we do that? I'm going to present you the issue that we are meeting and try to give a feeling how they are solved. So we start by the beginning, that is, we take two successive convex sets, T0, T1, as before. Okay? Now they are CK. And so we use, you remember, Minkowski sum. What about Minkowski sum of smooth objects? Well, if you take in R2 A and B, convex, compact, if you assume that they are CK, then A plus B is CK, indeed, when K equals 1, 2, 3, 4, but not 5. So it was a funny one when we discovered that, because natural at the end, but okay. So it's a bad news for us because it means that our trick is not working as it is, okay? And this fact is even worse in higher dimension, I think. I don't remember the number. Other obstructions. We have this T lambda, but we have also to work at the junction of the T lambda in order to smooth them, okay? Obviously, when you have this type of picture here, you don't have smoothness here, okay? And the same for the Armin. You arrive brutally to the Armin in the previous construction, okay? So we need to figure out how to do it. So we start with this first issue, what to do between T0 and T1. So for this, I'm going to use old tools, probably from the 19th century or before, maybe, I don't know. Because the answer is positive curvature, I guess it's 19th century. So here is the story. I take a smooth convex set, A, and the boundary is C2. It's important to have it C2. I take a vector in the circle, okay, with angle theta with the x-axis. And now I define CA theta to be a point on the boundary of A whose normal is n theta, like that. Okay? Well, you know this very well, specialist. Of course, we could have several CA theta. But I am going to assume that we have what we call the normal parametrization. That is, there is a unique guy here. There is equality. Okay? So we may define a function from S1, the circle, into the boundary of the convex set. I am going to assume that it is a diffeomorphism. And this is the way to define positive curvature. Okay? Well, it's the same thing as what we call uniform convexity, I guess, in our work. It's more practical to have it like that. And there is a wonderful extremality property of this normal parametrization, which goes like that. You take two guys. Also, here I forgot assumption. I mean, convex, compact, So, with positive curvature. And you look at the normal parametrization of A plus B, which doesn't exist, but which will exist. We can prove that A plus B has positive curvature and that CA plus B is CA plus CB. Okay, so there is a weird extremality property, which is very useful. Once you have this parametrization, you have also this one. And so A plus B has positive curvature as a consequence. And an immediate consequence of that also is that if A and B are CK, then A plus B is CK. You use the property of the regularity properties of this guy. Okay. We are now ready to see what it gives on our problem. We have T1 and T0, and so they are compact CK, and we assume, this is a new thing, that they have positive curvature. So we are adding an assumption. Now, because of what I said, T lambda is also CK and has positive curvature. Even better, the normal parametrization of T0 and T1 carries over the boundary of T lambda. So C lambda is equal to that because of the property I have just mentioned. Okay? Oh, this is nice. And it's even nicer, actually. I'm going to look at C as a function of the variable lambda theta, okay, from R2, well, sub-manifold of R2, to R2, R2. And we obtain a parametrization of the ring that we have here. I call this ring because it's a convex set with a convex hole. It's a ring. Okay, and so we have a system of coordinates. So I just want to mention one thing about the system of coordinates so that you have it in mind. If you fix lambda, so you fix lambda, and you look at theta, at this thing, theta gives C lambda theta, you have a parametrization of the boundary of the T lambda. Now you can do something a bit more funny.
Sorry, Jerome, could you hear us? Jerome?
Normal is constant by definition.
Jerome, sorry, it was some pause in the translation. Could you return to your talk 1 minute ago? Just repeat if it is possible. Because
at what stage here?
Yeah, okay, from this moment.
So from this moment, so I was saying that I take these properties and I now apply them to the rings T0 minus T1, okay? So I'm going to assume that my TIs have positive curvature. And so if they have positive curvature, I can apply what was before, and the T lambda are CK and also have positive curvature. Okay. The parametrization C0, C1 carries over to the T lambda because C lambda is equal to that by the previous theorem. So we have a parametrization of the boundary of the T lambda. And I was saying, maybe you missed that, that C as a function of lambda theta, C lambda theta, is actually a system of coordinates. If you fix theta, you have parametrization of the boundaries of the T lambda. And if you fix, it's funny, if you fix theta, you have the monochromatic segment here on which the normal are constants. Okay? That's okay? Now I have solved the issue of I have solved the issue with two convex sets. I'm going to be interested in the issue with three convex sets. So now I'm just considering twice the thing I have done. So I have this, okay, and now I have this, okay? So let us examine this case. And in particular, let us consider this line. Okay, what about this line? So this line is an iso-angle line. It means what? It means that along this line, the normal is always 1, 0, okay? But the normal here will be the gradient at the end of the story. So we don't have, whatever we do, if we take this interpolation, the gradient will not be smooth here. We have to do something at the junction. Okay, and so this is the part where it becomes very technical because we use many tools. because we want to bend the parametrization, preserve convexity. We also want to have control on the Hessian, okay? And so here I am going to be fast and simply say that we are managing to go from this situation, which is bad for the reason I told you, to, or maybe this one, where you have this angle here, to this one, where we have smoothed the angle and reorganized the value. And doing so, we have this CK convex interpolation theorem that we put with Edouard. So you take a sequence. So look, now it's a bit different. The sequence is indexed on Z. And okay, so it goes down and up also, okay? And you can interpolate this sequence by a CK convex function, F. So careful, we assume that the convex set have positive curvature. And in addition, we can ask the Hessian of F to be positive definite out of the argument. Okay, so this is a CK convex interpolation theorem that we have. Okay. So how long do I have? How long do I have? Can you tell me? How long do I have? I'm not connected.
Okay. Could you please?
How long do I have?
You have time. You have time because we start later, and so please continue.
Okay. Because now we are coming to the funny part. So we have in hand this smooth convex interpolation theorem, and we are going to use it to build convex counterexample. And we go back to our Gauss-Seidel method. So what are we going to do here? Well, nothing very difficult. We are going to take this picture, add slight curvature, okay, so that all the blue convex set have positive curvature. And we apply our theorem, okay? And then we have the existence of this spiraling sequence, okay? So there is no convergence of the Gauss-Seidel method in general, even if the function is very smooth. Let us now consider exact line search, okay? So here, you have your xi, you follow the gradient, and you choose the step which minimize the f over this line, okay? When you write down the optimality condition, you find this, okay, which is well known by all of you, you will teach that to your student, and you obtain pictures of this kind for this type of method. Well, we have an easy counterexample, which is given again by the same picture as before. Because if we take exactly the same picture, we start from here, xi. We need to prove it's not done. But let's start from here. We start from xi plus 1, okay? So the gradient is like that. So we minimize on this line. On this line, we have this orthogonality property. So the minimum is there. And we go on again, and go on again, etc. So we have a spiraling phenomenon again. And we do not have convergence of this exact line search. Let me now have a look at the directional convergence problem, which was inspired to you by some works in analytic geometry, which is, it is true. So let me recall what we are interested in. We have FCK convex with compact sublevel set, positivation out of its R-mean, which we assume that it is zero. And we are even in R2, if you like. Okay? So the curves XT of the gradient curve XT converge to zero. You remember the picture I made. And the question is, does the direction converge? Well, the answer is no, as I already said. I'm going to try to explain this on our counter example. So we are going to build a kind of a swirling pathological sequence of level sets. So it goes like that. So you take three level sets here that are homothetic. They are all the same at different scale from zero. You consider this triangle here, okay? And what you can do is prove that if a gradient a gradient curve enters the triangle here, it must go out of the triangle before reaching this level. So the picture must be like that. Okay? And so what we are going to do now, we are going to do the same picture as a small scale, very small scale, and turn it a bit, okay, so that the triangle will now be here. Okay? And we are going to do that again. So we are going to build this type of repulsing triangle with another angle and at another scale. So, and we are going to cover all the direction like that. So we have this sequence of repulsing triangle that is swirling, okay? And okay, now we smooth all this, we interpolate, and there are some details, and keeps the same property, and the function we obtain cannot have this quantity converging. Why? Because if this converge, it means that there is a stabilization of this direction. And if there is a stabilization of this direction, it means that at some point you must stay in some triangle like that. Because the angles are fixed here. Doesn't depend on the scale. And so this is not possible, and you have to go out of all triangles. So a bit after our publication, Aris Danilidis and some co-author proposed another funny counterexample. So here, you have ellipses that are rotating indefinitely around zero. And so in that case, you even have some type of spiraling phenomenon. So it's quite surprising. It was surprising for me to realize that there are spiraling phenomena in convex analysis. And let me finish with the Bregman method. So I have for I don't know 5 minutes, and I will be done. Yuri said a bit on that, but I briefly recall the framework. So we have what we call the Legendre function, okay? So what is it? Well, it is a function which is defined on some domain, okay? okay, C is a closed convex set with a non-empty interior. H is smooth on the interior of C. The gradient of H is a diffeomorphism from the interior of C to its image. Okay, this is what allows the mirror movement. Okay, you go into the dual and you bring back the information. And there is also a blow-up property, so the gradient explodes near the boundary. So these are the functions you know very well, x log x, minus log x, minus square root of x, okay, on R plus, okay? And now we are going to consider this Bregman method. So we take F convex smooth with this relative smoothness property evoked by Yuri. And our goal is to minimize F over this set, okay? And we do this method, where the step is must be lower than 1 over F, okay? So we know that the limit of Fxi is the minimum of F. But what about convergence, again? Well, convergence is doesn't occur in general, even in a very simple case. So I must say before that this counterexample is very long and necessitates tools that I haven't presented. But it's interesting, however. So we are going to look at the very simple problem. Minimize the first coordinate over the square 0, 1 in R2. So it's an easy problem, okay? So our F is linear. And it is relatively smooth with respect to any kernel we can think of. Okay? So we take some H and our algorithm goes like that. We can rewrite it like that. Okay? And here there is a funny thing because of the linearity of the cost. The algorithm is finally also rewritable like that. Okay? Okay. And we have a counterexample that I will present after with a picture. There is a function h on the square, which is Legendre, which is continuous on the closed square. It is important. It was difficult to have. So h is not blowing up on the boundary. It's continuous. And it is even CK on the interior. And the accumulation set of the Xi is the entire left edge of the square. Okay? So let me now give you a sense of what it is. So start here. Okay? So this is the algorithm we are studying. We start here. So in black here, you have your square, okay? In blue, you have the level lines of the monstrous H that we are going to consider. This H is minimal at x0, okay? So you can forget about that, okay? So that the algorithm has this property. Okay, and now what do we do? We are going to look at the level lines of H. The level lines of H have bumps like that, here, here, here. And at these bumps, the normal is along E1, okay? And the gradient of H is very long, of course, because H is getting bigger and bigger. And actually, we can prove that the Xi, if we start from here, we are interested in, lie on bumps like that. So you, the first Xi is there, and you can see the optimality condition. And then the one after is here, and the one after is there, etc. So what we are doing is that this bump are sliding from up to down, upper and even down, upper and even down, okay? And by doing this with a bump, we have the same behavior with a sequence which does this, and at the end it accumulates totally here. So, so this was the counter example I wanted, the last counter example I wanted to mention. I just conclude by saying that we have other counter examples. For instance, the kelp property is not true, and you can find the CK convex counter example and many others. So I think I will stop here. I guess I have. Use 5 minutes more. I don't, I'm not sure. Okay, thank you.
Okay, okay, thank you very much. Please, let's thank the speaker, first of all. And next, it's as far as I know, it's a paper. It's a free available paper. And if you are interested in this, counterexamples, you can find them in this paper of Jerome, and maybe our colleagues.
It should be accepted in MATPRO.
Ah, okay, it's okay. Maybe questions from the colleagues in Zoom.
Yeah, I have a question.
Yeah, Mark, please.
Can you show us again this Bregman stuff? This is interesting, actually. Show us from the beginning. I mean, what was your setting here before?
Oh, the setting is that you minimize a stupid problem. Minimize x1 over 0,1 to the square.
Okay.
Okay. So you have the square, and you want to maximize this thing. And the solution is here. Okay, so there is no problem. It's a linear problem, but the thing is that
you didn't pick a specific edge here.
Here, the f is super smooth, is linear.
No, not f, h.
And h, you have it here. H, yeah. Is this guy. So it's crazy. So h are making cliffs like that. Okay. And the cliff is kind of oscillating before reaching its maximum. So you have a bump here and a bump there and a bump there. So it's very hard to imagine.
But so that will fail in dimension three, right? That's what you're saying.
It's in dimension two.
Yeah. So I know. Can you? I mean, you cannot construct anything like that beyond the dimension two for this.
Oh, yes. We are going to. So we wanted the simple counter example. So if they are in R2, in R1, it's not true. But for the interpolation theorem, yes, it's true in Rn. But it's very. It doesn't look, but it's difficult. Huh? So it's long.
But then I have a stupid question. Why would you like to use such an edge for minimizing your function that you show us?
Well, so this is my geometer Sol, which is speaking. I guess that many of you are not interested in convergence or whatever.
I'm curious. I just want to know why. I mean,
I'm explaining. So this is a, and I always believe that a deep understanding of geometry is important. For instance, when Yuri this morning was speaking of bonding derivatives and all that, for me it makes perfectly sense, because here what we see is oscillation of curvature, and it means that in optimization you want to somehow control oscillation of curvature, and there is this famous work of Arkady and Yuri, in which they say, okay, I have a control of this oscillation in terms of the metric, the Hessian metric itself. So I think it tells us something. I don't know what exactly, but
thanks.
Sorry. Okay. Maybe more questions. Are there any questions from our room? Let's thank the speaker again. It was very nice. Thank you. It seems that such a book, maybe book, not even paper, counterexamples in optimization and numerical method of optimization, is very good idea. And we know such books in mathematical analysis in different.